Hello, I'm urologist Ömür Erdem Akkaya. Today we'll have a video presentation on testosterone preparations, application methods, and complications due to them. There are three kinds of testosterone preparations in our country. One is Virgen, one is Sustanon, and the other is Testogel. Testogel is not covered by SII. You take Virgen orally. It has approximately 23 mg of testosterone undecanoate in it. The bioavailability rate is very low, and the bioavailability rate is around 7%. 93% of the drug is eliminated by the liver. There is a great difference between taking on an empty stomach and on a full stomach. It is said to be about 10 times the difference. It needs to be taken on a full stomach. Obviously, it's not a substance we use to increase testosterone. It clearly increases testosterone in women, but how much it increases in men is questionable. Because liver elimination is very troublesome. Apart from that, there is Sustanon, the most commonly used and safest testosterone preparation. There are four types of testosterone esters. It's a mix of four to be effective in the short and long term. The intramuscular deep injection is made intermittently depending on the weight and height of the patient. For approximately 15 to 20 days, that is, deep injection is made into the muscle. A heavy drug may have pain that continues for several days after application. There is also Testogel. Testogel is also a preparation that does not allow fluctuations in testosterone levels, which provides a stable testosterone level applied to a hairless area in the skin. It's an expensive preparation and is currently not covered by the SSI. The disadvantage of Sustanon, as I said, is that it is compulsory to use a thick needle if a deep injection cannot be made. Of course, attention needs to be paid during injections. Sciatic nerve and peroneal nerve damage, vascular injuries, and intramuscular abscesses may occur. There is no such problem in Testogel. In Testogel, you may not reach the testosterone level you want, so you need to increase the application, which increases the cost. Apart from that, one of the biggest disadvantages of Testogel is that since it is applied through the skin, Testogel is likely to turn into dihydrotestosterone. In other words, testosterone can turn into dihydrotestosterone with the 5-alpha reductase enzymes in the area you apply. For fat people, it's a good thing to actually emphasize its androgenic effect. If we look at the preparations used abroad, there are those applied as nasal. Other than that, there are those applied as implants under the skin as controlled release. Apart from that, because testosterone enanthate is used, there are those who apply testosterone enanthate in the form of subcutaneous. In fact, preparations made like insulin injector pens were also started to be used in the form of auto-injections, that is, by simply changing the tip. You just change the tip and apply it subcutaneously once or twice a week. What is the advantage of subcutaneous injection? The pain is much less. When the infection develops, it can drain from the skin by anastomosing and serious intervention may not be required. There are injectors with finer tips than insulin injectors. Their trauma is much less, they are much easier to use. In subcutaneous injection, it is necessary to pay attention to something like this. If it is recommended to have a fat ratio of less than 20% to apply subcutaneous injection. Because when you do it under the skin, this testosterone can aromatize into estrogen. If it aromatizes into estrogen, most of the testosterone you supply will turn into estrogen. Maybe you will not be able to benefit as much as you want. Therefore, if the fat mass is below 20%, the subcutaneous application is recommended. If it is over 20%, intramuscular application is recommended in testosterone applications. I think the biggest problem with intramuscular applications is an abscess and sciatic nerve tissue injury. Abscesses also occur in two ways: either the material you use is infected, or you infect the environment during the injection. So, you are planting the microbe in the intramuscular area. What happens when it is planted? Either is eliminated by body resistance. If not eliminated, it takes 2 to 3 days for the abscess to occur. The abscess is seen with soft tissue ultrasonography or tomography, its size is checked, the amount of liquid in it, the amount of solid is evaluated. Antibiotic treatment is required to suppress the abscess. If the patient's body resistance is weak and already has diabetes or something, it can grow rapidly and spread to other tissues and cause gangrene. The patient may lose his leg or arm. It is a very dangerous situation for diabetics. Of course, athletes can limit themselves because they have body resistance. The treatment that should be done there, if the abscess does not shrink with antibiotics and does not disappear. There is only one treatment, drainage. When a window is open to the abscess, it empties and resolves on its own. Of course, a scar may be left on the skin. Apart from that, sciatic nerve injury may occur. I saw it 3 times. Here, in the intramuscular injection, it is necessary to pay attention to the injection in the gluteal region where sciatic nerve tracts are. I think the patient's lying position is extremely important while having an injection. Because tract changes, which is the area the sciatic nerve passes. The patient may be bending his hip, or bending his knee. It may be done by sitting and standing, which are extremely dangerous. Or, if there is bleeding in the area close to the sciatic nerve during the application, that bleeding may press on the sciatic nerve. What happens if the sciatic nerve is affected? Foot drop is the most common. When the patient is standing, he cannot lift his foot, cannot lift the tip of his foot upwards, and it hangs downward. If it happens, the possibility of recovery is high in young people and children, and if it is in the elderly, the possibility of recovery is a bit rare. But the thing is, no matter how accurately you do the injection, there is always a possibility of injury to the sciatic nerve. Even if you do not apply it directly to the sciatic nerve, it is always possible to damage the sciatic nerve by being affected by the damage of the surrounding tissues. It is a risk to take. Thanks for listening. Best regards.